Supporting Ukraine is not charity, but it is enlightened self-interest for Canada and for our democratic partners. So we need to understand that we are doing, you know, not only this is the right thing to do, but this is a smart thing to do. This is a strategic thing to do. And the second thing is that if we don't want to pay pennies today, we will pay hundreds of dollars in the future. We don't want to, if we don't want to, you know, go through the, you know, pain of short-term, you know, financial pains of increasing our defense spending, increasing our resources devoted to our security and prosperity. Our security and prosperity will be in peril down the road. It will cost a lot to us, not only in terms of treasure, but potentially in terms of blood as well.
Welcome to this week's episode of the CDA Institute Expert Series, the podcast that brings you in-depth conversations with the brightest minds in defense, security, foreign policy, and international relations. Each week, we delve into the most pressing issues facing our world today. It's July 10th, 2023, and in this week's episode, MLI Senior Fellow and Transatlantic Program Director Belkin Devlin and Zachary Paikin, researcher in the EU Foreign Policy Unit at CEPS, discuss what to expect from tomorrow's NATO summit, the focus of which will likely be on assisting Ukraine in its counteroffensive, and discussing the enhancement of the institutional relationship between NATO and Ukraine. The question of Ukraine's potential NATO membership will also be addressed. Other topics include the future of defense spending within NATO and the question of Sweden's accession to the alliance, challenges posed by China and climate change. This is the Expert Series. Dr. Devlin, nice to meet you, and thanks for coming on the CDA Institute's Expert Series program today. Pleasure to have you. So tomorrow we have the NATO summit coming up. What are some key topics or issues that you anticipate will be discussed at the upcoming summit, and what impact could these discussions have on Canada's defense and security interests?
I think there will be a number of issues that will be discussed, from Ukraine's relationship with NATO to the defense spending to how NATO should position itself when it comes to challenges in the Indo-Pacific, particularly with regards to China, to climate change and the impact of climate change on member states' security, particularly in the Arctic, but also not only there, and a number of other issues, including approval of the defense new defense plans. I mean, they are, of course, confidential, but would that be a step going forward to approve them, the capabilities, thinking defense and deterrence in Europe, significantly raising the number of available troops, almost tenfold, going about 40,000 to, slightly over 300,000, how it's going to be made. So a bunch of issues, I think, that will be discussed. But I would say, three of them will be the center stage. The obvious one, the big one, is Ukraine's relationship with NATO. Now, no one is expecting an immediate membership of Ukraine to NATO, especially when the war is going on. But I think what is the trajectory of this relationship will be the central question for this summit. So that's number one. I'm happy to sort of expand on that in a minute. What kind of a relationship NATO will have Ukraine going forward, and we do have different camps on that issue. The second one is the China issue. How to deal with a more increasingly assertive China? What are NATO as an institution, as well as NATO member states, what are their equities in Indo-Pacific, and the stability and security of the Indo-Pacific? AP4, Asia-Pacific 4, which was invited to the Madrid summit last year, will also be in Vilnius next week. The AP4 refers to, of course, Japan, South Korea, New Zealand, and Australia. Again, that also represents an important and increasing understanding that what happens in the Indo-Pacific will not stay in the Indo-Pacific, and it has a significant impact on NATO member states, their security and prosperity, and how to deal with that issue. There are clearly fissures within the alliance. Today, there are the recent reports that Macron is blocking, for example, the opening of in NATO sort of liaison office in Tokyo, etc. So. How to deal with that is going to be a major issue, and my assumption is that Americans will be actually pushing harder on that particular issue. The third one is, of course, is the defense spending aspect. 2% of GDP? Is it going to be the floor? Is it going to be the ceiling? Is it aspirational target, or is this a minimum that the member states need to commit? That will be a big issue, and of course, this matters a lot for Canada because we are only spending about 1.3% of the GDP on defense, and our allies are increasingly vocal. About the criticisms of Canada in that sense, not pulling its weight. So we need to be able to address to that. So those are the three broad themes. Let me go back to the first item and then sort of expand them each a little bit, and why those things matter for Canada, as well as what other aspects, especially NS forward presence, particularly our status as a framework nation in Latvia, and how that plays into Canadian security commitments and interests in NATO. So expand a little bit on those issues. The Ukraine issue is going to be an extremely important part, and I think the clear the push for that comes particularly from our Baltic and Polish as well as our Nordic allies and UK and increasingly France is that we need to be able to provide a very clear pathway for Ukraine in Ukraine's membership in NATO after the war, and whether what shape that particular set of commitments will take place. I think it will come down to the wire in this summit. There seems to be a particular reluctance on the part of Americans as well as the Germans to go beyond the language of the 2008 Bucharest summit. But there's a strong pushback on it. And I think in a Canadian position needs to be that Canada is very strongly in favor of Ukraine's membership in NATO, that we need to go beyond the Bucharest summit declaration. And although defense minister Anand declined to sort of come out very clearly in terms of fast track membership, I think that is going to be a very important component for Canada, that we need to come out in favor of dropping the membership action plan and call for a clear pathway with clear deadlines and timelines and procedures for Ukraine to be a NATO member, at least having those timelines to be decided in the next summit in Washington, the 75th anniversary of NATO's establishment next year in 2024. So I think there we really need to clearly align ourselves with our Baltic, Polish, French, British allies, and call for a fast-track membership for Ukraine that will make Europe much more secure. And again, I think the red herring here is when people call about when there's a war going on, we cannot have Ukraine in NATO. It means a war between NATO and Russia. No one is calling for immediate membership for Ukraine right now, including the Ukrainians themselves. And if you look at the announcements and speeches, everyone is referring to the post-war membership. But we need to have this very clear vision. So that's number one. And I think where we would go with that is going to be an important component. The trick here is that how to bridge that gap between eventual membership for Ukraine in NATO with increased security commitments and guarantees today. And I think there are several options that have been suggested. One option is this famous sort of Israeli option, basically making the commitments, security commitments to Ukraine by a set of coalition of the willing, in a way, a set of multilateral agreements between willing NATO states to make clear, binding, long-term, multi-year commitments to support Ukraine and its armed forces. And I think Canada here should also play a role, make it very clear that we do have are willing to provide security commitments, including support for Ukraine militarily, providing ammunition and weapons and so on and so forth, in a very clearly lined up structure going forward. And I think that sort of bridging is important. And the expected announcement of NATO Ukraine Council in Vilnius could play a fundamental role, and they should definitely replace NATO Russia Council. And in addition to that, I think we should be calling for the official termination of NATO Russia Founding Act of 1997. I mean, Russia is obviously have been violating this for over a decade now, and by officially terminating that act, we also should call for in a permanent stationing of NATO troops in the eastern flank, and I'll come to that when we talk about the EFP in a minute. So I think there are multiple things that Canada can do in coordination with its allies to support Ukraine until the NATO membership, and which should be, and Canada should come out in favor of a fast track membership for Ukraine, and also willing to provide the necessary resources and security commitments to Ukraine in the meantime. And there are multiple ways we can do it. We may not have the stocks to send the weapons, but we could underwrite the production of them. We could underwrite the private investments in defense sector. We could, and this is something we have argued with my MLI colleague Jonathan Berkshire Miller in a recent op-ed, that Canada could set up an insurance fund for Canadian defense companies to engage in investments in Ukraine for the defense sector, and guarantee their investments to enable them to be able to go there, for example. So there are things that we can do, even if we don't have, I don't know, a million 155 shells to send to Ukraine. So that's number one. Number two, China. China, how to deal with that particular challenge, and understanding that the challenge we face in the Indo-Pacific and in Europe are integrated. It's increasing alignment between Russia and China. We need to understand that there is no option there won't be any option for either our European allies or for Canada in case there is a contingency in the Taiwan Straits or South China Sea. You know, we will not be able to, to be frank, say that we will sit this one out, Americans, you take care of it. That is not going to be the case, not only for the American side, but also for our partners and allies in Indo-Pacific. I think, both South Korea and Japan, as well as Australia, particularly, made it very clear that their commitments is not only sort of the moral thing to do, the right thing to do when it comes to, Russia's illegal war in Ukraine, to support Ukraine, unprecedented support, particularly for a country like Japan, for example. But also the expectation is that these are integrated, challenges, and that they would expect Canada and the Europeans to be there for them if there is a similar contingency. Just doesn't mean that we need to send German ships to Taiwan to sort things these things out, but it would mean that they cannot sit this one out, continue business as usual with China, etc., and thus increasing coordination between NATO member states as well and our Indo-Pacific allies is going to be a very important component. And unwillingness or the reluctance to recognize this particular reality among some European countries, especially Germany, but increasingly, Macron's comments about Indo-Pacific being someone else's sort of issue is not going to be helpful. And I don't think we will solve this issue in Vilnius in that particular way. But I think the message needs to be quite clear that this is not something NATO member states could sit out. Doesn't mean militarily getting involved, but it means that we need to coordinate much better with our allies and partners in the region. Lastly, the defense spending. It will be a major issue, coming up and understanding it. Yes, I agree that it's not a particularly great metric. Like any metric, it's somewhat arbitrary. And with any measurement things, when you try to have a metric, you try to work towards the metric rather than a particular, what it's supposed to measure. So there are problems with the 2% metric itself. However, that doesn't change the fact that this is something that has been agreed upon, that most of our allies are trying to get there. The and the international security environment change rapidly, that we need to be able to put funds and resources there. And that's the expectation. That's the price to have a seat at the table. And our allies are increasingly vocal about their criticisms of Canada, of not made, you know, or not really making any plans to meet. You know, I was hoping that the defense policy update would have been out before the summit, but I think there would be serious questions and tough questions coming and a frank discussion. When Prime Minister Trudeau will be in Vilnius to see what Canada is prepared to do, and we need to be we need to make sure that we are assuring our allies that we will be meeting our commitments. We are making concrete steps, taking concrete steps with clear timelines to reach that particular goal. It's not going to be from here to tomorrow, but I think what our allies would like to see is a serious commitment, without any wiggle room or vague terminology, with dollars attached on how Canada will get to that that level of commitment, and what will be the specific capabilities that Canada can bring to bear on the defense of the alliance. The fact that we did not take part in the Air Defender, for example, in 23, the largest sort of the air defense exercise in NATO, the fact that we're no longer joining the air policing task force, which we did for years, because we don't have the necessary personnel, the planes. The fact that we still did not sort of commit to increasing the EFB presence from a battalion size to a brigade size, etc., are all results of not devoting the necessary resources, both equipment purchases, etc., but also to when it comes to the personnel and retention and recruitment, so on and so forth. So our allies would expect that would be a tough challenge and call, and I would expect a strong push for making it almost official that the 2% should be a floor, not a ceiling. So those are, I would say, the three things and how they really relate to Canada. And on a particularly, I know you have a few other questions as well, but on a particularly relevant aspect for Canada is, of course, the mission in Latvia, and what the how we will be meeting our commitments that are made in Madrid summit when it comes to our Latvian partners, as well as the broader NATO commitments. Germans recently announced, for example, that they will be permanently stationing 4,000 troops in Lithuania by, I think, 2027, I want to say. I don't remember the exact date. As soon as the bases are finished there. Our Danish partners announced their commitment to the Canada-led Enhanced Forward Presence mission in Latvia, about 800, 900 Danish troops before we sort of announced our own increased contributions to it. There will be pressure and expectations coming on what will be the, what's the plan, what's the game plan to increase the EFB group from a battalion size to brigade size. And as the framework nation, Canada should be able to provide a game plan. It doesn't mean that we would need to send 3,000 more troops and cover it all ourselves. But we need to be able to provide a game plan, working with our allies, how we will get there, so that our position there is not going to be the weak link in that defense space. So that is going to be a hard set of questions. We need to be able to make a credible commitment and provide a game plan of how we are planning to get to the brigade level in Latvia. And last thing, and something I wish hopefully would come up and may or may not come up, is that increasing attention to the Arctic as a theater of operations and a security concern. Now, the situation in the European Arctic is different than the Canadian Arctic. There are different issues to consider, but it's very clear that our Nordic allies you know, in Denmark and Norway and Finland, and hopefully soon Sweden will be a member as well, is taking this very seriously, upgrading their capabilities, working together in a much closer format, while we are not particularly, seem to be interested in expanding not only our capabilities, but also partnerships, and still have this reluctance to involve NATO in the Canadian Arctic more. I think that has to change. We need to understand that as one part of the Arctic is getting more secure, if we do not follow up and devote necessary resources for surveillance, for reconnaissance, for undersea surveillance, space-based assets, et cetera, we are creating a weak spot that can be exploited not only by Russia but also China. And it is, of course, his home. It is here. It's his Canadian sovereignty issue as well. I think that a particular focus on the Arctic and a change of tone and more willingness on the Canadian side to involve our NATO partners in securing the Arctic is something I wish to see, but I'm not particularly sure that will be the case. And my last point on this is that this is true for our Baltic allies and our Arctic allies and ourselves as well, that we need to start thinking Arctic and the Baltic as connected areas. That is how our adversaries think. The Russians call it, from Arctic through the Baltics, through the Black Sea, through to the the Mediterranean, the Wall of Steel, right? So they think in terms of a connected set of areas. The Chinese are increasingly thinking about particularly the Eastern Passage as way of getting to the Atlantic as well as other places. We need to start thinking Arctic and Baltic in a much more connected way. Whether we like it or not, we are not only an Arctic nation, but also a Baltic nation, but a very fact that we are the framework nation in Latvia. We have the largest outside presence of any Canadian mission in Latvia, and almost all the Baltic states are also Arctic states, especially our Nordic friends. So those are very connected areas. We need to start thinking of their security in a connected way as well.
Well, Dr. Devlin, that was about as thorough and insightful a response as I could have hoped for. And you actually touched on almost every question I had prepared. So I'd like to skip ahead to one more question before we wrap things up. And you touched on it a little bit, but I'm hoping we can really dive in and elaborate a bit more. So given the complex nature of the conflict in Ukraine and the ever-present potential for escalation, from your perspective, how does NATO continue to strike a balance between giving Ukraine its much needed support and provoking a larger military confrontation?
I think there are two parts to this answer. I think one is that NATO not only has been, striking a good balance, we are actually, I would say, a bit too timid and too reserved in our support, too much fearful of a potential escalation. I will explain a little bit on why I think that is the wrong way of thinking. So we could actually do more, including providing long range strike capabilities, aircraft, etc. I have been arguing since March 2022 that drip, drip, drip kind of support for Ukraine is actually increasing the cost for not only for Ukrainians in terms of blood and treasure, but also for ourselves. It is prolonging the war. It is encouraging Russia, getting there by kicking and screaming, slowly delivering those capabilities is actually not making NATO countries more safe. It is by extending the war, by prolonging and providing Russia with a hope that they could outweigh the West, is we are actually inadvertently increasing the risk for a confrontation between Russia and NATO member states. So I think the balance is actually even more on the timid side, and I think we should be able to do more. Now, why I think I'm not particularly concerned about a provoking a larger war or escalating it to Russia-China, Russia-NATO confrontation. Words are one thing, actions are another, right? So the economists call it, stated preferences versus revealed preferences. When you look at what the Russians are doing, they do bring their personnel and troops from Kaliningrad, from borders in Finland, from their borders with Lithuania and other places. They did take their armed forces and sent them to Ukraine. If they were expecting a confrontation with NATO, I don't think you would start depleting your troops there. What doesn't change is the Russian strategic forces, which are primarily nuclear forces, primarily focused and stationed in the Russian Arctic. And I think it's very clear that the message has been from the Americans, but also from other NATO states, that there is no intention of attacking Russia from the NATO part, and the Russians understand this. Therefore, they are actually, shifting their troops, their armed forces, to their illegal war and occupation in Ukraine. If they were, feeling that there is a possibility for escalation from NATO, they wouldn't be engaging in such behavior. That's number one. Number two is that it's very clear that the nuclear deterrence is holding. There is no change in their nuclear posture. There are words coming out of crazy people like Medvedev about nuclear escalation here and there, but there are no signs on the ground that the Russians are preparing for a potential escalation to the nuclear level. And again, I think that has been made very clear from the NATO side that NATO has no intention of attacking Russia, and that the nuclear stability is holding. So from the actions of the Russians, we can see that they are not concerned about escalation with NATO. And that means that we are credibly signaling our intentions to the Russians. So I do not necessarily see a mechanism in which this war could escalate right now. Things could change. This is war. Fog of war happens, and all that kind of thing. But I think the behavioral signs, not the rhetoric. I mean, of course, Putin is claiming that this is all we're fighting with NATO and all that kind of thing. But their actions are suggesting that they're very clear that there is no threat from NATO to Russia, and therefore the level of support. And NATO troops and NATO countries were very clear that there will not be NATO troops fighting in Ukraine, etc. So, increasing support and giving Ukrainians whatever they need in terms of the tools to finish the job will not necessarily increase the confrontation. Everyone brings up the issue of Crimea, but I think we'll cross that particular bridge when we are there. One clear sign to me, and I will end on this one, that despite the sort of the public perception, Putin is a very risk averse leader. He adjusts and adapts when he faced with resistance. He changes his tactics. He only moves when he thinks he has a greater chance of success. And his biggest miscalculation, of course, back in February 2022, was that the West would roll over. Now, why did he think that? Well, in 2008, they marched in Georgia, nothing happened. 2014, they marched into Ukraine and seized and annexed Crimea, nothing happened. 2015, intervened in the Syrian civil war. West didn't really respond. Same story with Libya. Why would he think that the West would react differently? Putin is a risk-averse leader. When faced with challenges, such as their failed blitzkrieg to Kiev in the beginning of the war, they change tactics and focus on other places. So it is, to me, quite clear that a strong, determined opposition to Putin does not lead to escalation. It leads to Putin reassessing its aims and strategies and shifting that. He is a risk-averse leader. He's not a risk-seeking leader. You know, he's a guy who sits on a table that is 20 feet away from everyone else. Is extremely concerned about his political survival, his physical survival. You don't get into an escalation spiral where you might end up in a nuclear war if you're concerned that much. So I not only sort of the in other words, not only we don't see on the ground changes that suggest that the Russians are worried about escalation with NATO. What we know of Putin, his psychology, his worldview, his beliefs, his actions suggest that he does, he does not respond to pushback by escalating. He responds to it by backing off. So I think those things suggest that there is still a lot more room to go in terms of NATO providing support to Ukraine. A lot more room to go before we need to start worrying about an escalation between NATO and Russia.
Balkan, thanks for taking some time to be on the program today. Thank you for your very thoughtful, nuanced answers, especially ahead of your travel schedule. Before we wrap up things, I'd like to give you the opportunity to share any final thoughts or drive home any ideas or points that you think are important.
There are two phrases that I keep saying whenever I had opportunity, and I think it's important for Canadians to understand this and hear this again and again. The first one is supporting Ukraine is not charity, but it is enlightened self-interest for Canada and for our democratic partners. So we need to understand that we are doing, not only this is the right thing to do, but this is a smart thing to do. This is a strategic thing to do. And the second thing is that if we don't want to pay pennies today, we will pay hundreds of dollars in the future. We don't want to, if we don't want to, go through the, pain of short-term, financial pains of increasing our defense spending, increasing our resources devoted to our security and prosperity. Our security and prosperity will be in peril down the road. It will cost a lot to us, not only in terms of treasure, but potentially in terms of blood as well. So we need to take the steps today so that we don't pay a bigger price tomorrow. And we need to understand that the world changed. So we need to step up.
Balkan, once again, thanks so much. Take care. Well, Dr. Paikin, great to meet you and thanks for coming on the program today. I really appreciate it. So let's set the scene a little bit. Tomorrow we have the upcoming NATO summit. What are some key topics or issues that you anticipate will be discussed at the upcoming NATO summit? And what impact could these discussions have on Canada's defense and security interests?
Well, there's a number of topics that are going to be discussed. Most importantly, basically trying to assist Ukraine as much as possible in its current counteroffensive and going forward throughout the context of this war. And related to that issue, of course, is the extent to which the institutional relationship between NATO and Ukraine will be enhanced. And of course, this relates to the question of whether or not Ukraine should be offered NATO membership at some point. The official position, of course, of NATO is that Ukraine will become a member at some point. But the question is, of course, how to create a tangible pathway for that to happen and whether indeed that is something that will realistically happen. So everything sort of related to the Ukraine front is certainly going to loom large. But there are some broader strategic questions as well, including the future of defense spending within the alliance, basically whether the 2% benchmark of GDP spent on defense is going to become a floor, basically going forward rather than a ceiling. This is obviously something that's of relevance to Canada, given that we spend around 1.3% of our GDP on defense, which is significantly lower than the 2% goal. Whether or not that is a goal that we should be aspiring to as a country individually, irrespective of NATO, is a question that's very much open to debate. And where that money should be allocated is also something that we need to think about as Canadians, because we have interests not just in the Euro-Atlantic theater from a defense and security perspective, but also in Asia and also in the Arctic. So these are things that we're going to need to think about. So basically, there's this tendency in Canada to have what Kim Nossel calls the North Atlantic anchor, that basically NATO has very much shaped a significant amount of our foreign policy and our foreign policy identity, really, in the post-war era. But the extent to which these NATO summits really shape Canada's overall defense orientation is something that, obviously we're going to have to think about from a grand strategic perspective. And then the final issue, of course, that's going to be on the table and perhaps not resolved is the question of Sweden's accession to the alliance, which is of importance to Canada as well. Given that Sweden is a member of the Arctic Council as well. And so there are increasing questions over whether or not the other seven members of the Arctic Council, excluding Russia, will be able to institutionalize their cooperation through NATO, right? Some are talking about an Arctic Seven. And so, you know, Sweden's membership in the alliance would be of relevance, not just to NATO in the Baltic theater, but of course, to the Arctic as well, and the extent to which Canada will be able to inject a further dynamic of defense and security into its Arctic relations as well.
How can NATO address the concerns of member countries that are hesitant to commit to Ukraine's membership while the war is ongoing? And from your perspective, what would you say are some of the underlying geopolitical considerations that inform their reluctance to extend an invitation to Ukraine?
I don't know if I would call it geopolitical concerns or considerations. I'd call it direct security concerns. If you admit a country that's at war with Russia to NATO, then NATO is at war with Russia. And that's a pretty serious business we'd be talking about right there. The flip side of this is that, of course, if you say that Ukraine can join, but only once the war is over, then you're giving Vladimir Putin a pretty good excuse to keep this war going for as long as possible. And I urge your listeners to make no mistake. It doesn't matter how many sanctions we impose on Russia. It doesn't matter, you know, how much territory in Ukraine Russia loses. If the Russians want to keep waging this war, they can, and they will be able to do so for years to come. So, you know, this is a major consideration related to Ukraine's accession to NATO, whether it's during this war or after the war. And I think we're, you know, pretty clearly in a situation now where admitting a country would theoretically reduce, you know, the security of existing NATO members rather than enhance it. And it was easy to avoid that trade-off with previous rounds of NATO expansion or enlargement. But, you know, now we're dealing with a country that's directly at war with Russia, so it's a lot more complicated. And so the idea of NATO expansion proceeding as it has throughout the post-Cold War era for ideological reasons or for altruistic reasons or whatever reasons, you can't do that anymore. There are much more serious security trade-offs right now. And it points to the reality, ultimately, that when it comes to the future shape of Europe's security order, we will at some point have to sit down and talk to Russia about what that's going to look like. And that isn't going to be today necessarily. It might not be for a long time, but we really do need to acknowledge that NATO and NATO alone cannot unilaterally set the terms of European security. And that doesn't mean we compromise on Ukraine's territorial sovereignty or anything like that, but it just goes to show that, you know, Russia is in Europe. It's going to remain a power of some kind, a significant one, maybe not a global great power, but a power with 140 odd million people with nuclear weapons and a military that we ultimately, even though it might not be, as some people say, 10 feet tall, it still won't be one that we can ignore.
You touched on this a little bit in your first answer, but I'm hoping you can elaborate a bit further. What decisions would you say might be expected from the Vilnius summit in terms of Ukraine's membership aspirations and the security guarantees that may be offered?
Well, I think, you know, we're going to see a number of things. We're already seeing that there's going to be an upgrading of the institutional relationship between NATO and Ukraine to the level of a council. So that's going to allow for deeper crisis cooperation, dialogue in general. I'm sure that we're going to see, you know, elements of the current level of military assistance provided to Ukraine be formalized and continued. You know, there have been reports that basically we're likely to see some form of guarantees on training of Ukrainian troops, you know, on defense policy reforms, perhaps on intelligence sharing, things like this. So, you know, there's a number of different vectors throughout which we'll be able to likely to witness a deeper institutionalized cooperation and security assurances, assistance, et cetera. Whether you call it guarantees or not, that you know, becomes a little bit trickier. I don't know, you know, when is appropriate really to use that term or not. What actually will be discussed that could plausibly rise to the level of guarantees? Because ultimately a guarantee means, you know, we're actually prepared to do something almost in a legally binding sense. And, you know, Ukraine, everyone likes to cite the 1994 Budapest Memorandum, you know, as guaranteeing Ukraine's sovereignty and territorial integrity. What that memorandum provided was security assurances for Ukraine, not security guarantees. There's something very different between an assurance and a guarantee. And even now we're talking here about guarantees that fall short, of course, of Article 5. So again, you know, I'm sure that allies are thinking this over, you know, quite substantially about what level of guarantee they're actually prepared to lock in here. Even if it's not Article 5, we're still talking about a heck of a lot of investment in assisting, you know, Ukraine militarily. possibly for many years to come, if this war continues for many years to come, and whether we've got the money and the wherewithal to do that, even as China's becoming increasingly important in the world, even as there are, you know, global governance needs that need to be addressed elsewhere, debt restructuring, you know, fighting pandemics, fighting climate change, you know, we have limited resources. And we're going to have to ask ourselves ultimately, if we want to shape the international order of the future, is that going to be done in Asia? Is that going to be done on global governance issues that appeal to the global South? You know, or is it going to be done, you know, on the narrow Euro-Atlantic Ukrainian, you know, issue in particular? And so there are some tough trade-offs there. And it just goes to show that in a multipolar world, you can't do everything necessarily all the time. There are competing pressures on resources that we're going to have to reflect on. And strategy ultimately is about making choices and understanding trade-offs and understanding that you can't do everything all the time. So I'm sure we're going to be thinking about the difficulties of and the level of investment and what kind of language we're prepared to agree on as allies as we go into this summit. But you know, it's also important to think about this not just in the context of European security and as it relates to Ukraine specifically, but also to think about, you know, where our priorities in Europe fit into the broader global tapestry that's evolving as well and the pressures we face across the board.
To what extent does the expansion of NATO represent a legitimate security concern for Russia? And how does this perception align with broader geopolitical dynamics in the region?
So, you know, Russians across the board have been saying that they view NATO expansion as threatening for a very long time. Doesn't matter if you're nationalist, statist, liberal, if you're Yeltsin, if you're Putin, you know, but members of the elite, even liberal dissidents. I mean, no one has really been of the view that NATO expansion, very few people, I should say, have been of the view in relative terms in Russia that NATO expansion is a good thing for Russia or for Russia-West relations. So the question, however, is, are we really talking about a tangible security concern in the material sense, or are we talking about something deeper? Are we talking about sort of an identity, you know, based malaise as it relates to Russia's relationship with the West, right? The perception, in my view, at least in Moscow, was not so much that there's a tangible security threat to Russia, but more the broader perception that the West was creating a post-Cold War European security order that largely excluded Russia, that was not to Russia's advantage, that basically, you know, allowed the West to say, we're going to do whatever we want, whenever we want. And, you know, Russia will consult with you, but, you know, we're not going to give you a veto ultimately over European security affairs. And it's that perception of being excluded from Europe that NATO expansion really helped to drive home. And it played on Russia's insecurities after the collapse of the Soviet Union. So that's going to be there no matter what. And, you know, you can try to assure the Russians for as long as you want that NATO expansion isn't directed against anyone. I don't think they're going to buy it. At the end of the day, ultimately, you know, countries in Central and Eastern Europe join NATO because, you know, they remember what you know, their experience was with Russia in previous centuries, and they didn't want to go through that ever again. And so clearly, you know, NATO expansion, whether we like it or not, was in some sense directed against Russia. And so you run into this fundamental trade-off of the Russians saying that, you know, in order for their security concerns or status concerns, whatever you want to call them, to be met, there needs to be some sort of Russian control over who gets into NATO, or at least, you know, where NATO gets to place, you know, troops and equipment on its own territory, which of course completely, you know, contradicts what many Central and Eastern European countries view as being the sort of baseline for ensuring their own security. So I don't know how you square that circle. And obviously that's something we're going to have to keep thinking about if we want to build at some point a more stable and secure Europe.
What does NATO's longer-term relationship with Ukraine look like, considering Ukraine's counteroffensive and internal upheavals in Russia? Or is it too early to tell?
Certainly, a lot will depend on the outcome of this war, and there are so many different variables in terms of how the end game of this war might turn out. So it's very difficult to say. What we can say is that, at least as of right now, what it looks like is that, you know, Ukraine is no longer going to be a neutral country or a buffer state. The idea of a fully neutral Ukraine as a compromise settlement to allow some kind of stabilization of relations between Russia and the West no longer appears to be on the table. Whether or not Ukraine, you know, formally is admitted to NATO, Ukraine today is de facto a part of the Western, you know, security and institutional community. And that's going to remain the case, I would think. And, you know, we're probably going to see on the European Union side of things, in all likelihood, the formal opening of accession negotiations for Ukraine's EU membership by the end of the year. And again, it may take many years before Ukraine obtains full membership, but if the EU does manage to confront issues related to its own reforms, certainly major challenges, to say the least, and, you know, some progress is continually made, perhaps towards a staged model of accession for Ukraine to enter Europe, the European Union, rather gradually speaking, then we could end up in a you know, as time goes by, a much clearer situation where again Ukraine is, you know, anchored firmly in the West, even if it is not fully an EU member or fully a NATO member tomorrow. So you know, based on the way things look right now, you know, that's the general direction in which we're headed. But of course, a lot does depend on what happens on the battlefield. And, you know, if Ukraine's counteroffensive turns out not to go anywhere, and, you know, Ukraine loses a lot of men and a lot of equipment in this counteroffensive, there's a possibility that Russia at that point might want to try to press its advantage on the battlefield. And who knows what kind of gains they would be able to make at that point. But it may make, you know, our calculations in the West a little bit more complicated in terms of the degree to which we're actually going to be prepared to support them, and how that will impact the institutional setup obviously remains to be seen.
Zach, thanks for taking some time to be on the program today. Do you have any final thoughts or key ideas you'd like to drive home for our listeners?
Well, I think we covered a lot of that. In terms of EU-NATO relations, you know, that's something that has also seemingly fundamentally transformed, not only since the start of the war, but certainly since the start of the war. Which, you know, is obviously going to shape the future of European security as well, quite substantially. So, you know, you're seeing a situation now where, you know, Emmanuel Macron, the president of France, you know, has gone in a very short amount of time from calling NATO brain dead to basically urging, you know, NATO to create some kind of a pathway for Ukrainian membership. And we saw him recently at the Globsec summit in Bratislava mention, you know, the extent to which acknowledging rather the extent to which, you know, France has prioritized security concerns of Central and Eastern European states. And, you know, that has obviously, you know, made it much more difficult for the EU and all of its members to agree on a common foreign and security approach, you know, towards Russia. And it perhaps does clear the pathway now to an even deeper relationship towards what some call an increasingly European NATO going forward, because the extent to which the EU now can be a fully strategically autonomous actor, you know, in the wake of Europe's clear dependence on the United States for its own security after Russia's invasion of Ukraine is very much, you know, doubtful. We might see the EU engage in certain forms of strategic sovereignty on, you know, making decisions related to technology, to climate change, to trade and industrial policy, to relations with China, things like this. These will be, you know, the subject of negotiations, obviously, between the US and the EU. But nonetheless, when it relates to questions of European security, you know, the EU is, you know, it's but surely, you know, trying to, you know, procure more stuff together. You know, the extent to which, you know, that will be successful, you know, already questions have been thrown up, given, you know, how quickly we're seeing decisions that are being made to try to replenish stocks, you know, in European countries. So, you know, we're starting to see a situation where the EU is not going to be, you know, an actor that will be, you know, a military Westphalian actor in the traditional sense of the term. You know, it may get more serious about doing some things on defense, but at the end of the day, NATO is going to remain the bedrock of Europe's defense. And so European countries, you know, finding ways to harmonize effectively, you know, the EU and NATO's activities and goals, you know, seems to be the way of the future on this front. And so that's also going to raise questions about the EU's role, Europe's role in the world, and America's role in the world as well, whether the United States will actually, you know, the extent to which the United States will be able to pivot away from Europe to focus on other theaters. All these issues are really going to be, are really wrapped up, you know, in what's going on right now on this sort of EU-NATO front as well.
Zach, once again, thanks for joining us on the program. Great to have you on and look forward to future engagements. That's all for this week's episode of the CDA Institute Expert Series. To learn more about the CDA Institute, you can visit our website at cdainstitute.ca or subscribe to our newsletter. Thanks, and we hope you'll be joining us next week.